So I'm just going to read through. I'm kind of. I guess I'll compress. You know what I've read here. Obviously the article talks about the importance of errors and whatnot, but it's shocking to see how much of an impact these things have. According to the Consortium for Information and Software Quality, which, by the way, we're going to read, I think, in one or two tabs, poor software quality costs U.S. companies upwards of $2 trillion annually. Poor software quality costs U.S. companies upwards of $2 trillion a year. I just want to read that one more time. Poor software quality costs U.S. companies upwards of $2 trillion a year. These losses include costs from operational failures, unsuccessful projects, and software errors in legacy systems. Now, to be fair, if my argument is more along the lines of what we're producing these days isn't that great, then having issues in legacy systems, it's not fair to kind of smuggle that in. So, even if it's like a third, let's say we cut everything down by a third, that is still a substantial amount of issues and money. Operational problems contributed the largest share with $1.56 trillion in losses. However, Siskiyou notes that technical debt is taking center stage as one of the most insidious detractors from profitable software systems. Now, here's my issue with this right off the bat. Again, if you have amazing, incredible software developer experience tools, and developers can produce code, you know, and feel nice about the code they produce in ways that they could never feel before, you know, like the new young hot thing in your life never made me feel this way before. Why is it that technical debt is increasing as one of the major factors of these costs? I would imagine, to me, and maybe this is something that has to do with like definitionally what is developer experience, I would imagine that I would see technical tech debt go down because it would mean that developers have more capabilities of wrangling the code in front of them and increasing the quality of it because their tooling is better. Now, as it so happens, after this stream, my next stream is going to do a very deep dive into what is developer experience, because I think there are different definitions and it's a lot more subjective. I will try and present some scientific data. There is some. There have been some longitudinal studies about developer experience from the developer perspective. Unfortunately, it still leaves... it's like a scientific approach to a subjective experience, but we're still going to get into it so that we can kind of have a better sense of like, what is developer experience? So maybe I'm pointing the finger at developer experience and going, well, it's not producing good stuff, is it? But we have to look at that. So we're going to look at that next. But for the time being, if we can just, whether developer experience is fantastic or not, we can at least start looking at these numbers and frankly being shocked by what's going on with the state of the industry, because at least for me, these are not numbers that are known by even the general programmer from my experience with other programmers. Let's look at the obvious bills first. The downtime and PR agony of a big public software failure. Here are a few recent cautionary tales that illustrate the impact of a catastrophic failure or breach. The big Facebook outage in 2021, remember that? I should certainly do. It was reported to cost $65 million in advertising revenue and temporarily tanked Mark Zuckerberg's personal wealth to the tune of $6 billion. Twitter has famously suffered an ongoing series of outages since Elon Musk's extensive layoffs, during which period the stock price also plummeted to a third of its former value. While this no doubt related to other turbulence and negative press, the recurring outages play a major role. The most far-reaching outages occur in the services that form the infrastructure of much of the internet, like Cloudflare and AWS. The economic impact hits not just the providers themselves, but their clients, and in turn, their customers at the consumer level, which means all the way down to you and me. The infamous SolarWinds attack cost 18,000 clients an average of $12 million each. Impacted companies in the U.S. reported an average of 14% impact on their annual revenue. SolarWinds itself has $40 million in upfront recovery costs, plus their stock plummeted from $25 a share in 2020 to about $9. That's a huge drop. In September 2022, hackers stole $160 million from crypto platform Wintermute. In March 2022, hackers stole $620 million in Ethereum cryptocurrency from play-to-earn game Axie Infinity. In June 2023, hackers stole $35 million in crypto from Atomic Wallet. In fact, analysts say that hackers stole a combined total of $4 billion in crypto in 2022. While crypto is clearly a major target, it's far from the only one. According to Cybersecurity Ventures, cybercrime costs alone will reach $10.5 trillion annually by 2025, and the U.S. will shoulder at least one-third of that cost. Let me just put on dark mode here. Will it work? No, it won't work. Sorry, folks. The cost of software is to your company, so obviously that's going to be a huge cost. How about labor costs for software errors? How about that? The time the developers spend finding and fixing bugs is time that costs the business money, plus the opportunity costs of not building new features. As we just covered above, finding and fixing bugs is a big ticket item in your development lifecycle. So exactly how much does it cost you? According to VentureBeat, developers spend 20% of their time fixing bugs. We'll get into some stats, some actual data on that in a bit. The average salary of a software engineer in the USA is hovering around $100,000, approximately. That's about $20,000 a year spent on fixing software errors per developer. I want to read that again. That's about $20,000 a year spent on fixing software errors per developer. Per developer. On top of developer salary expenses, unaddressed software errors affect end users, and when your product doesn't work as intended for your customers, support costs start to mount. And here's another thing. Here's something people don't talk about. Everybody loves to say, oh, the market doesn't care about performance. The market doesn't care about bugs and defects and issues. Not only does the market care, as proven by earning losses when products can't perform well, or they have too many defects or bugs, or they take too much time to load. That's the customer's way of complaining, even though they might not raise their hand or write a report or write a review or anything like that. And furthermore, some of these security issues that have plagued us for the last few years in particular, a lot of the big ones, have gone unnoticed by many, many people. And one of the most recent ones, which I'm going to get into in a future security-based stream, one of the most recent ones was constantly throwing up an error that should have been discovered much earlier. It was a security error, but it was an error nonetheless. But customers and users were so used to seeing these things that they didn't even report it. It was just commonplace to see things crash, to see errors every 5 minutes. You know, again, I'm being hyperbolic, but I think you get the point. Just because it's not reported doesn't mean it's not experienced. And you cannot make the case that non-reporting is non-experience. It is actually experienced. The markets, as we're about to go into, show that. The state of the industry kind of shows that. And the fact that there's customer and user satisfaction reports where these kinds of issues have a direct impact on, for example, customers' willingness to engage with your software is a form of reporting. It's just not the reporting that bros who want to defend this stance have, which is like, well, I don't hear customers telling me about it, or, you know, writing vast numbers of reviews about it, so it doesn't exist. Nobody cares. Yeah, no, everybody cares. They just have become so used to it, they don't say anything about it. You should be aiming for this kind of reactive work, finding and fixing errors, support costs, to take no more than 20% of developer hours, allowing 80% on proactive work, building features and improving your products, rather than vice versa. If we assume that your team adheres to this 80-20 standard based on a 40-hour work week, the average software developer spends 32 hours fixing errors and replicating issues each month. That's almost a whole week per month focused on fixing errors and replicating issues. per developer. If you have 50 developers, the combined 1,600 hours of reactive work could potentially ramp up the cost of software errors to US$83,000 in lost time per month. Then there's the opportunity cost of time spent away from building regular features for customers. Reducing 1,600 hours by 50% to 800 hours would save your company about $41,500 every month in salary expenses while increasing overall product and software quality. So this is a survey. I think I'm going to go over it. What is the biggest barrier to finding and fixing bugs in your backlog faster? Getting the bug to reproduce. Boy, do I know this one. How do you cut back on your labor costs of errors? Unsurprisingly, the answer is automation. A huge component of the bug fixing process is the time spent triaging and diagnosing issues. So now here's the thing. I'm going to kind of give you a little sneak peek. When I do the future stream on developer experience, there is one study, because there's not a heck of a lot of them, but there is one study that goes over what developers count to be an impact, positively, negatively, or neutrally, to their developer experience. And it is shocking to me that the only study that kind of, at least the only one I could find that had a pretty comprehensive view of this, I think, developers tended to not trust their automation tools. They found it to be more of a negative impact because they didn't know how to use their automation tools. They didn't know what their automation tools were doing under the hood, or they simply trusted the automation tools to do what it was telling them to do without actually checking into it. And as a result, when it came to, well, why the hell am I having issues when I have an automation tool that's supposed to fix these issues for me? Those three things had a negative impact overall on their developer experience. So even this, I don't think, is some kind of like panacea or kill shot to developer experience. Now, it's pretty obvious. I don't think I have to tell very many people that if you're going to have software errors, then your customer retention and loyalty is going to drop. So for example, we're going to touch on some of these stats. 47% of consumers expect a web page to load in 2 seconds or less. I think we've talked about that before. 40% abandon a website that takes more than 3 seconds to load. 79% of users who are dissatisfied with website performance are less likely to return. 50% of users state that quick page loading is important to their site loyalty. A 1 second delay or 3 seconds of waiting decreases customer satisfaction by about 16%. 44% of users will tell their friends about a bad experience online. So in terms of what does this have to do with businesses are actually leaving money on the table by not spending some money focused on dealing with these issues internally with their development team. I know it at first glance, from a managerial perspective or an executive perspective, the cost of trying to ensure that you produce quality software or you produce a quality website or you focus on performance, and then what you leave on the table is kind of like features. That's the way it kind of looks like, you know, at first glance. But the problem is that a leaning to the opposite direction where you stop caring so much about the quality and performance of whatever it is you're building to focus way more on features than you should, you're actually limiting yourself on the amount of income you can make, and you're making your customers unhappy. So obviously investor trust is going to have a cost if investors are seeing that your company cannot produce something that's of quality. Boeing here is one of the biggest ones that has happened recently. With some of their planes, they've had issues. Tesla reliability has been iffy at times, and they've taken a nosedive. There's opportunity loss. So what happens? In terms of time and budget, only 10 to 40% of technology projects are successful. I know we have some statistics coming up next that we're going to go over. 47% of projects have problems with timescales and budgets and result in low quality products. That is a cultural thing for sure that needs to change at the developer, managerial, and executive level, at the company level, whatever you want to call it. But the industry as a whole has a role to play in that. But The evidence, I believe, is clear that if you are a company looking to make more money than you would normally think to make, even if you have a good chance of making a lot of money, you still are kind of cutting yourself off from even more money by not taking into account these kinds of things. Then you have developer turnover. 26 of developers in a global survey said they spend half their time fixing bugs. That's a stat we're going to look at. 10% in the Western US said this occupies up to 75% of their time, which is absolutely freaking mind-boggling. 44% called bug fixing their biggest pain point. 55% said it kept them from building new features and functionality. 12% felt resentful about manual bug fixing. 7% said it makes them want to quit. This is especially confronting given when the tech sector has the highest staff attrition rates of any industry, and within this, software engineers have an even higher turnover rate of 21.7%. Now, I think this is from 2023, so things might be changing this year given, you know, changes with like layoffs and whatnot this year, but even just for 2023, that is a staggering amount of negative statistics. But the tooling, the developer experience has never been better, right? Preventing software errors is better than fixing them. So there isn't really any statistics here. This is kind of more of an opinion, but I would tend to agree that it is better to be proactive than reactive, which is not happening right now. And then better testing tools, automating deployment, prioritizing bug fixes, security first approach, etc., etc. So that is essentially this article. So already I don't think we're off to a good start, and I'm having a difficult time tying off the idea that developer experience because of tooling has never been better, and yet I see statistics like this in 2023, 2024.